Okay, so a bit about string force. What we're going to talk about here is essentially about high-vol complex event processing of security information. Some of the things that we can say about events is that, as you guys know, think about all the internet and all the connected devices and all sort of information that they generate. We are actually talking about a huge amount of information that is available and you can consider that as events. Another thing about events is that they are basically volatile. They exist at a certain moment in time and then they aren't there anymore. I think that's a good analogy. That's something that you can see on the slide. It's a good analogy about the nature of security events. Since we're talking about essentially large quantities of security related events, I can help with add here some of the big data baseload because in fact we are talking about large volume of data. Our focus on this big data paradigm is not so much on the volume from a storage perspective, but it's much more on the two other things. So this is one of the known definitions of big data, so volume, variety and velocity. Our focus is really on the variety and velocity part. So it's about dealing with multiple and different data sources, and it's about doing that as fast as possible with near zero latency. So that's really the goal with our complex event processor. Some of the problems, or shall I say, the issues when tackling with this particular big data security event field. Is what we can see below. So the first I already mentioned that, so it's really the massive amount of events that we need to handle and how to do that and actually deliver those events with zero latency. Because we are not talking just about proxying events, it's about processing them and creating something out of the events. The other interesting challenge is about how to create mechanisms that allow us to share all those events amongst different organizations or research teams or, I don't know, CERTs, ISPs, whatever entities have this particular need of sharing events, security event information amongst each other. The other is how to do this using a unique and common API that is able to deal with both publishing events and consuming events, and allow you to do complex queries on top of the data that is available on the complex event processor. So basically what we created was what can be considered, of course, a complex event processor. The whole idea was to make it highly scalable and really focus on performance. I have some numbers here, basically on a very commodity hardware. Dealing with real life events is capable of doing around 50k events per second, and real life events, not laboratory created stuff. The whole idea is, of course, to use streaming technology, so we are not concerned about storing events on a database. That's really not our concern. Our concern is to be able to push those events as fast as possible, process them, and make the data available to whoever needs to listen to that data. It also follows a common publish-subscribe model. So the whole idea is that you subscribe to the API and you say, or basically whoever provisions your key says, hey, here's an access key to the API. It allows us to see this feed A and feed B and feed C. Inside those feeds, you can basically reserve certain attributes or anonymize some data or do something else, so it's quite flexible on that aspect. Another thing about the API is that everything happens in JSON. So the whole idea was to decide on a data format that can be very easily used both by applications and backends and make that available end-to-end. So events are basically issued to publish in JSON format. When you query the API for certain events, you also get JSON format. So therefore, there's a really way to love Jason, as you can see here, with a nice and big one t-shirt. Yeah, the thing since we were talking about security events, it's also, like I mentioned, quite important to make sure that the platform can is able to basically provide mechanisms to share the events. This is one of the one example of a model of sharing events amongst multiple groups or organizations. So call it a federated model for this. So as a recap, so basically we created this thing called Streamforce. Streamforce is essentially complexity processing. The whole idea, as you can see here on this diagram, is to publish tons and tons and tons of information that can be basically everything you want. Of course, we are a security company, so we are concerned about everything that can be relevant from a security perspective. So be that social networks, traps, reports, reputation, whatever data you can publish with you. It is really our data. And then on the other side, since we provide a fully and very flexible API, and all the events are in JSON, it's really, really easy to create all sorts of applications on top of that. But before going into the applications, so one of the obvious outputs of something like this is that we can very easily have an offer of feeds, which we call cyber feeds. Cyber feeds is basically a set of feeds that we think are relevant for security research, and we provide that as a package on top of the API. The cyber feed is essentially like a group of feeds, right? That it's available for consumption. It contains things like sinkhole data, trap data, IP reputation, and a bunch of other stuff as well. Just to get an idea of the volume, for example, for sinkhole data, we usually deal with about 400 million botnet checkings per day. So that's the sort of information that is available on the API query. For traps, we have, I think last time I saw it was anywhere between 15 to 20 million messages reaching our traps, which is great because, as you know, email is still one of the major vectors of trying to infect someone. So it's very good to have email metadata that tells you which are the URIs that are being used for whatever exploitation, things like that. IP reputation, also one of the things that we have, that will give you basically in real time events that basically trigger an IP reputation change. So it's basically saying that this IP suddenly got a bad reputation or good reputation. We are tracking around, I'd say, 20 million IP addresses active on doing basically that stuff that we can map to the IP reputation. That data is available on the field as well. So because this is an API, and on the API there are a lot of feeds available, it also means that you can basically create your own feeds by querying the API and executing some of its functions, and selecting what you want or you want to see. You can basically essentially create your own feed with the data that matters to you. You can also do interesting stuff, like for example, measuring things, trends, and all that sort of things, grouping events, correlating, deduplication, so the kind of stuff that you would expect from a CDP, which is important because when dealing with millions and millions of events, you really need to do some branching on the fly, make sure that you only get the relevant data. High volume, so normally on a normal day on the cyber feed of the whole platform, we have around 6,000 events per second, always available to consumers. And we are, of course, always adding more data, either improving the feeds we have or adding new feeds that are again relevant for security. Applications. So basically, like we learned JSON, right? So it's easy, really easy to create all sorts of applications that can consume directly from the API. So we basically created plenty of applications to do that. I am sure going to show you one example. If I can. Okay, so this, I guess you guys can't read this very well, but basically what this is a web dashboard. It's a dashboard that doesn't require any application layers, so you don't actually need a server to run that, you can run it on your own PC or whatever, because it's basically static HTML files. And what it does is connects directly to the stream, the stream API, and makes that data available to you and creates all sorts of visualization charts, which is great if you want to understand what's going on at this particular moment in time. So essentially, what this gives us is, first, we have like a group of templates, or let's call it examples of charts that are very common and we might want to use to check out the behavior of a particular botnet or things like that. And then we can also use this advanced form, which is basically a way to make it, let's say, easier to query the API, because the API can be both very complex and difficult to use, right? Because there's so much things you can do on top of it that you need to make it a bit easier for, let's say, normal people to be able to use it. So we created this form. And basically, it's a gateway to the API that will create charts for you on the criteria that you want. I'm going to show you a quick example. For example, let me see which one. So I mentioned that we have a huge sinkholing platform which does around 400 million events per day. We're tracking, I think, somewhere between 3 million or 5 million infected devices worldwide. And this example that I'm going to show you is basically querying the API for a specific type of Trojan. In this case, it's Zeus, it could be something else. The Zeus or Zbot family basically group them all in one category. It is going to add the georeference for each IP address that we see. And we are grouping this by city because it's way too many events to show on an application like this. We do deduplication by city. And it's basically this. So let me just click here. That's what it looks. So basically what we are seeing here right now is botnet check-ins from the Zeus or Zbot family in real time as they happen. So every time an IP address infected with some sort of Zeus variation connects to our samples, something shows up here on the map. Of course, just we are doing the duplication, so just to make sure that we don't get too many problems, or the browser will not be able to work with this. So this is an example that we saw. Basically, it uses the API, the fields that are available on the sinkholes. It will apply geolocalization so that you can do it on the map. Another thing is if we want to just basically measure how big the botnets are or how they compare one to the other, we can basically do a query to the API. So these are at this moment in time, again, so this is happening in real time, right? There is no database that we are querying. So at this moment in time, based on the amount of botnet check-ins that we are seeing on the sinkholing platform, this is the top, let's call it, malware families that are alive and kicking and reaching our sinkholes. Again, this is botnet check-ins, does not necessarily mean that these are the top botnets, because somebody else will do check it more often than others. But it gives us a pretty good idea that we try the one. Of course, this dashboard is dynamic, so you can create graphs, basically drag and drop the graphs. Create another one. I can't read the so yes, let me just. Since we are in Drupal, we can, for example, basically do the same as say that okay, I'm interested only in the same things from Belgium. It's essentially the same thing I showed you before, except we need to do it in Belgium. Like I can see here, I'm basically manipulating the form which translates from API query. I really hate to lose. So this one is specific to Belgium, right? So what's happening right now in Belgium in terms of .NET infections? That which he also calls this is representing the whole So let me go show you guys all the last one and let's move to the other part of the presentation. Here's another. Here's another example. So again, I'm using as a template the pie chart, except that instead of grouping by family, I'm grouping this by ASCII name. So we will see if I click here. Basically, a line chart of the top ASCIIs with infections reaching our samples. So, to wrap up, there are plenty of template charts here that you can use to go around. Each time you click on a chart, it will show you what sort of attributes you need to fill the criteria to work with that, and you can change the criteria. That's the whole idea. You can work with several types of charts actually. I only showed you my line chart, pie chart, and vector map, but there are others here as well. So that's basically it. Now we're going to move to the second part of the presentation. So, how do you collect all those events from the stream and generate some reports or real-time visualizations other than the ones you just see. So we have around 6,000 events per second and they peak at over 10,000 events. So we are going to focus on the botnet feed, which is the bank Trojan, which usually peaks at around 4,000 events. Zeus example. So basically, this is what we get. We can't understand anything that's going on, so we want this. So, how are we going to process all these events? First, we are going to use the string to help us reduce those events from 4,000 to around 1,000. How we are going to group by machine in Trojan. Basically, things, multiple events from a machine Trojan group will be received as one
fields and by a geolocation model to give us the exact,
okay,
most exact location possible to that machine. So how are you going to process and study these events? First, I'm going to give some technical introduction for those who don't know these technologies. We are using Node.js, server-side JavaScript engine built on V8. On top of V8, while it's great for prototyping fast and it's scalable and it has models for everything. So we are going to connect it to MongoDB and Redis MongoDB from to use as a storage for later analyzing what we are receiving, and Redis for real-time counters of infections in multiple countries, ISNs, etc. So we built three applications: the collector, the worker, and the processor. Basically, the events come from the stream, they are collected by the collector, they are distributed to the workers, and then persisted to the databases. Basically, the processor is an aggregator that stores information for later analyzation and statistical studies. The MongoDB database, as I said, is a real-time information of infected machines. Real-time is basically the machines that we look as inactive. That means that have the machines that have produced events in the last 24 hours. Redis is the real-time counters only. I will give you some example of the information we are collecting. So the collector maintains information on MongoDB, it removes the non-active machines. It also determines the counters when those machines are removed. At that point, we can send warnings, for example, a botnet that no longer exists. Or that has decreased in size. It also sends the events to the workers. Workers then create new entries on the MongoDB for unseen machines, and it adds information about new Trojans domains for command and center domains for a specific machine. So one machine we call machine, but it's an IP address. One IP address can be a network net, so we have a lot of trojans for an IP. So it will also update the last time we received an event from that machine. Redis will store the counters. Basically, when we add new information, we will increment the counters that are associated with that event. So new entries, incremental counters, existing entries incremental on the Trojan specific counter. It will be possible to even send warnings about those increasing in the size of the botnet or new infection in compromising, etc. The processor basically groups information by botnet, ISCN, country, and the grouping of each, and it also persists that information to MongoDB. So basically, we are creating a database that we can query and check how many infections the country had last week at a specific hour. The real-time 24 hours database looks like this. It's basically a geolocation, the time it was created, the domains that are being used as a controlled command centers at that machine, last time to communicate it basically with that command center. And ASN. We also generate an IP numeric. It's a numeric representation of IP that helps with the querying of network rings. This is the aggregated information, basically one entry per hour. We are pre-allocating those entries, so at the start of the day, all the entries are at zero, and throughout the day it's going to be updated. This is a way that to don't overload MongoDB. So basically we don't extend documents throughout the day, but we extend them only once per document. Sorry, there is also the metadata information that describes the entry, in this case China and configure at that text. So to give you an idea of the current testing environment, we are using 4 MongoDB charts. We have over 3 million infected machines, around 2 gigabits of data. Those indexes are just to mention how we speed up everything. So for example, if you found a country, found a host name that we want to go above, it's instantaneous. We are also using aggregated information for more than 100 days. We have over 80 million entries, around 6.5 gigabits of data, and around 56 megabytes per day, which is pretty low. This is what the counters look like, basically. It's the concatenation, botnet, country, for example, and the number of affected machines at that time. We also have the Trojan, country, and the others. Redis, as I said, it's very fast. That's our machine, over 1,000 requests per second. It's perfect for keeping counters. The usage is very low, so we can scale from 1,000 events per second to 10 times more. 30% of the chance. So we also have an API that allows us to query the MongoDB and Redis database. We should be able to use MongoDB for the simplest queries, but not the more specifics, like querying for network runs or a specific day. We have to convert all the query. Limitations of the data collection approach. Basically, we are grouping the events, so we, for example, if you group the events each 5 minutes, we aren't going to receive the real-time information of a machine. For example, if we have 100 events that 5 minutes, we will only receive one, so we can't use that information for example, for determining how many machines are behind that network. Also, MongoDB can be slow. If the hard drives are slow, everything will just stop after some hours. It will start slowing down the workers, and the information won't be persisted as fast as it should. Also, the workers have some mechanisms to discard information if it's coming too fast. For example, if we have a new botnet with 1,000 of events per second, we can't register those events immediately, but we can add workers at a later time. So how can we evolve what we currently have? Basically, we can start sending more warnings, defining thresholds for those warnings. We can aggregate information not only by day, like we do today, at the processor, but by week, month, year, so we can get the median number of infected machines in a month for a specific country, for example. We are also getting information by hour. We probably could rate by 10 minutes or a minute, but at this point there is no use for it. We can also data mine the information we already have. A lot of things would be interesting to find out, the periodic number of events by a specific machine in a certain time frame. etc. So we can also apply all this to other fields. We chose the botnet because it's the one that has more valuable information we can share. So we have also information about spams, Twitter, etc. Moving to the reports. A lot of people have to work asked for reports for a specific country in the last week, for example, or the last day or something, and if I delete information from an active machine every 24 hours, basically we won't have that information. So the reports are a way to go around and keep that information. Basically, we have a server in the generator. Server has an API to request and maintain the reports, and the generator has it's basically generating, gets the word, returns the report and stores it. We have reports in CSV format. We also store it in MongoDB with FS. Basically, that is the description of the report. The report itself is in the file in this case, but for example, in this case, we have the JSON. So basically, we can query the data from last week. We can check a specific network in a specific time. Basically, being able to query everything. Botnet, Zoos, ISCM, X. So we can also add other formats to this. Reports, charts, we are currently sending emails with the reports, we can send charts, pretty charts with it, so we teach email. We can also collect other types of charts for spam, Twitter, etc. Like I said previously, we have to evolve the collector first and start collecting those, that information. So how do we visualize all that information in real time, specifically the botnet information? John showed the map version 2D, but there's a prettier version. We can see what the countries are there and not there. You can shoot up by botnet, for example, and see where the botnet is more active. We are just putting one point in a specific geo. What if we wanted to, we couldn't see if there are any points. We have the connection per second, they are a bit low at this time. 3.7 million factor machines, and at this time Zeus is in active, is the number one effective. This is available at our website if you want to check it. So how is this built? Basically, we connect to the stream, ask for the bank origin field, group by family and country, and group time is 5 seconds. We don't receive events smaller with a time frame smaller than 5 seconds for a specific origin country. We also filter the events, and the KPI model deals with the top countries infections, top countries causing infections. So the screen does all the work for the world. We also use Node.js as a way to connect the browser to the screen, just for keeping the screen safe from a complete fast attack or something. Or a large number of coins trying to access the globe. At the browser, we use the normal jQuery, Socket.io client, also WebGL and web workers to convert the GL location to the specific point in the screen where you're going to show the dots. How to evolve the goal so we can create this HUD, like again, interact with the goal and ask for even specific operations, for example, request a scan, port scan at a specific location of the goal for a specific botnet, for example. We can also display warnings and other kind of information. I can show you a better version of this new goal. No interaction in here, but if it works. Let's see if it's not appearing. Basically, it's the same dots, but we have warnings that say that inform us what happened in a specific example. Puerto Rico has just been affected by configuration at ISN something. Choose a larger top, like the, it's just a top like the other filter. The warning is the so, how do we add valuable information to information that we already have? For I can give some examples later. Mainly, those operations that would have that add better information are expensive, CPU or bandwidth-wise, and approach, a master slave approach that will enable us to distribute the work among multiple machines, we call it minions. Basically, it's requesters, multiple types of requesters, DNS, kind, etc. Request for work in the master store that work, minions will request work to process and will send back the results. It's a modular architecture, so it's pretty easy to add new models for new type of work. For example, we have DNS, data mining and scanning modules. This information is then pre-injected in stream, so basically a botnet with a certain IP can be scanned, and the scan information is then sent back to the stream, so everybody can share that information. I'm going now to pass to Thiago.
Hello everyone. So these guys are guys who handle stream and all that part. We're from different teams actually. We came together because I have my security team and they had some interesting problems I wanted to fuck around with. So I just went to them and asked them, can I play with your products? And they gave me access to it, so I started playing with it. So what am I interested in? I'm interested in port scanning. I did a bit of work on port scanning and all that part. And I'm also interested, obviously, in visualizing the data I get from port scanning. And that's what I want to talk to you guys a little bit about. So, port scanning done right. If you guys have been looking at the news lately, around like the last month and a half, there's been some pretty cool tools related to port scanning, like ZMAP and MassScan. Well, that's actually always really cool to have tools that are super, super fast. However, if you're doing port scanning from single server in the US, you're fucking dumb, because you're not going to get reliable results. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that. So, when you're trying to do port scanning, right now, lots of people are doing this. So they choose like 0000, put a super duper server with a gigabit of connection and throws a quadrillion packets a second, scanning the entire world. There is just a tiny problem with this, which is lots and lots of countries will not give you an answer back. They'll either time out, they'll be blocking you, and it's just not reliable data, okay? And so how do we get reliable data from a port scan? You won't be able to get it from a single server. You'll need something similar to this, a distributed server. And it's not just about having a distributed server, it's knowing what to do with that distributed server, okay? So, if we look at some data that I have here, this is some tests that we did. We essentially bought some cheap VPSs from like China, Russia, Australia, USA, and started scanning the same networks in all different countries. And if you guys look at some of the results we got, it's pretty interesting, because like some networks that you scan, for example, if you look at Angola, you only got results back from Portugal, and even those were extremely unstable. We would get lots and lots of timeouts because, you know, the connections there are not that great at the moment. Same for other countries. You cannot scan a single thing, like the entire network at least, from a single country. So it's not about having mass scan running on a gigabit, it's about knowing what to do with all the different port scanners that you have, okay? So if you are into port scanning is fun, but if you're not HD or event community, you're gonna have a bad time. We started using RamNode and it was actually quite fun because we got tons and tons and tons of news reports. And of course, by the end of the week, ITI can no longer offer you the service, given the volume of emails I'm getting, please move along. And they refunded us the entire money we spent on it because we had bought CBS there for like a year. Doing port scan, you actually need lots of minutes in different parts of the world, as I explained. It doesn't require an amazing CPU or RAM. You do need some good Ethernet connection though. We need to store the data we get from that, and we need to query that data, okay? So if you guys think about a little bit from what my colleagues were explaining, so they have the last two parts done right. They can store data, a lot of it, they can query it super fast, real time, stored, whatever, it doesn't matter. So how could we possibly now get cheap minions? Because when we started this, me and Tiago were on a tight budget and we just needed minions. So we decided to do this. Combine Raspberry Pi's Model B, 512 of RAM, Ethernet card, grab PwnPy, version of Kali or Backtrack for the Raspberry Pi, put some Node.js on it, put some minion scripts, and we had our minions. And then we installed a couple and we had something like this. Essentially a distributed system of port scanning cheap using Raspberry Pis. Just moving along. Then, after you finish port scanning, you have lots and lots and lots of files because you get lots and lots and lots of data. Well, what can you then do with that data? You can do something like this. Who here has used Shodan? Anyone? Okay, Shodan is fucking amazing. Congratulations to the guy who built it. It's awesome. However, querying and looking for data, for me, it's too slow. So we decided to try and write something which was a little bit faster. And what we came up with was this.
Just a sec, sorry.
So essentially, we've got something running on their backend with the stream and all that stuff using Node.js, MongoDB, which is much, much faster. For example, if we wanted to look for machines in country Portugal, PT, boom, instant. If we want to look for, let's say, Telnet, for example, we can just go here. And you can see it's really, really, really fast. And we can have the entire data from the entire port scans of the entire world, and it works at this speed. Just to give you just a little bit more of an idea of how fast it is, I'll just show you this. So this video was not sped up in any way, it's real time, and it's essentially me doing a query on the master database, which has all the data. This is me just pressing that forward arrow key. As you can see, it just doesn't stop, just keeps on giving all our data without any slowdowns or anything. And this is what I wish we could have with Shodan, because they have an amazing scanning system, they just need a faster querying and consulting and exporting data system. And this is something we could possibly find.
that we could do together.
So what I, why do I care about force scanning? Because then we can start doing cool stuff. As I explained, I like force scanning, like data visualization, like data querying. So we can start doing stuff like this. Looking at, for example, the most infected countries or countries we get the most data from, start classifying them. We can look at internet status. What are the most ports open? Can anyone tell me what's wrong with this picture? Anyone? We are security guys. If we were in our optimal world, what's wrong with this picture? Really? No?
Lot of port
80 instead of 443, and lots of talent instead of SSH. And this is one of the big problems we have on the internet right now. And just one last note, we've been looking at the NSA shit and all that, and what we're doing right now, government can do it, China can do it, whatever can do it. So I ask, what if you start doing evil stuff? What if you start combining all the modules from Metasploit, Exploit Database, combined with the data we have, auto-exploitation of machines all over the world and stuff like that? Essentially, you can have your own private botnet and it's not that expensive. Just to finish up my part, we want you guys to play with this as well. We're creating a stream just for you guys. You'll be able to look at this at the video or just come with us and we'll give you access to this. We'll give you access to the stream. Show us what you can do with the data we have, with all the botnet data, with all the port scan data. It's not up yet, we're putting it up, but just come and see us and tell us what you think you can do. Perhaps we can find something cool we can work on together. On a last note, no, we did not get infected by bot IRC SD bot. That was actually us just doing some testing on the stream and visiting some domains that are related to botnets and XME actually thought we were infected by a botnet. So, any questions? Yep. You can shout if you want. How did I manage to what now? That's wrong, I'll give that
to you. I know.
Let me do a bit of a good call. Okay, so basically, it's not really like this. Essentially, it's by having set probes on multiple ISPs. We are listening to the traffic patterns such as the ones created by DNS and HTTP, and we are basically identifying as much as we can domain names that either were used or are being used or are going to be used as domain control. And we basically register and take over those domains every time we can. So, and of course, all the bots start talking with us. Sorry? Okay. Not everyone can do what? To have the... It's actually, it's a good example because I was talking about complex event processing and it's a very good example of when you have this huge amount of data from ISPs that you can push to the complex event processor. It turns out that it's actually easy or it's not very difficult to use the processing capabilities of the CDP to extract botnets domain service. That's why we are able to do it at this scale.
I wanted to know how complete your port scanning data was. So, for example, like how many ports have you done, and how widespread have you done your port scanning? Like, have you done the internet yet, and how fast is it distributed?
Actually, yeah, that was what I was saying. So, essentially, like when we started this project, we started this around November last year. We were doing the entire internet. That's another thing. Like, there's still lots of countries that have dynamic IPs and stuff like that. So results you're getting in 1 hour are not going to be the same again in the same hour.
Are you just doing the top 1,000 ports, or are you doing all ports?
In the beginning, we were doing all ports.
And sorry for all of the questions, but in terms of the messages that you were getting from,
that's real time.
Oh, Jesus. So in terms of all of the, because I've tried to do something similar, right, with like VPSs, and I've got the same abuse messages that you have, and you ended up putting them on Raspberry Pis and just distributing them. Did you just put them in somebody's home and then just...
With some of them work, some people don't, because they have connections, like I said, 100 megabits, it's plenty enough for you to be in India. Yeah. If there's anyone out there from a cool country that wants to help us out, we're looking for Armenians. We'll provide a Raspberry Pi and everything goes to the US.
And share the information on the stream if you want.
Have you had any issues with like home ISPs?
So if you don't want to get like, if you want to get rid of 90% of the abuse, exclude Brazil from their scams.
Yeah. I'm not banks sure. From Brazil.
Banks from the Brazil, they are not happy about our scams.
Oh, and this is the map, not the fastest scam.
Actually, yeah, this was the slow version of our port scam, because here we were still using NMAP, and by the NMAP, it's very good for the service, finding the service that's running on a certain port, but speed-wise, you can see the scam in there.
Are you using NMAP now? Oh,
it's basically Zmap.
Yes,
One year ago.
I'll come and speak to you about it afterwards.
Hello. My question is pretty simple. Didn't you get it blocked by SAPs, or did you get two problems just running this bunch of scans all over?
We got a ton of abuse mail, I'll give you that, but and that's actually one of the reasons why we stopped doing this. Like I said, we were scanning the entire internet for a long time, from like November until February, March, then we stopped because we knew we were going to start getting blocked. Some countries we did get blocked, like Brazil, all the banks and stuff like that started blocking us, but yeah.
Right. We have time for one more question.
If anyone wants to learn a bit more about the stream or how to do cool graphs or how to start querying stuff, just come meet us after. We're happy to give a couple of demos and start getting you guys to play with it. So
can you put the API URL on there?
You're still going to need the API key, and it's not here. We will tweet the API key. If you go to this URL right now, it's going to ask you for a key. Oh, sorry. But yeah, we'll just follow us on Twitter, or just look on Brucon hashtag and we'll tweet it there, the key, when we have it set up. Any more questions? Anyone? Well, thank you very much then. I'll see you all at the party soon.